Hello and welcome to Purlfect Pairings. This is episode 3. My name is Gayanne, she, her.
And my name's Nicole, and my pronouns are she and her.
We'd like to start today by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we're recording today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. We are coming to you from Melbourne, Australia, and the indigenous name for Melbourne is Narm. And we like to start our podcast formally with this acknowledgement. Now, just a bit of housekeeping. If you like our show, could you please hit the thumbs up, which will be under the bottom of the screen. You'll see it down below. And if you'd like to know more about when our episodes are produced, you can subscribe to our channel, and that button is also below the video in YouTube. We will also give links to everything we talk about today in the show notes, so you can consult that if you want to learn more about what we're doing, what we're knitting, what we're drinking, and so
also forth. If we forget anything during the episode.
And if we forget something.
We'll all be covered in the show notes as well.
Another admin thing that I want to talk about is the comments. So we've had some really lovely feedback from the people who have watched our show so far, and we love to look at the comments and respond. We've been responding to I think all of them with at least a heart. I know we do work full-time, and we've had a bit more time off I think during the holiday period, but we do love the feedback, and we want to produce content that you would like to watch. So if you have suggestions about future episodes, please put it in the comments.
And so one of our goals for this vlog or podcast is to showcase our local yarn industry in Australia. And that will be one of the really important things we wanted to bring you is interviews with everyone from producers through to retailers. So we're really thrilled for our first interview on Purlfect Pairings to have an interview with one of our very, very local yarn stores, probably our closest yarn store, and one that we both really enjoy going to and have done for a number of years. So this is Emily Baldwin from Maker Maker, which is a beautiful local yarn store in Brunswick East in Melbourne. Yeah, how do you get to the point of opening a yarn store?
It was a long time coming. I've been a knitter and a crocheter for a really long time now. I was thinking about it this morning, and I think I took up crocheting 12 years ago or something.
Okay.
Something like that. And somewhere along that, pretty early on in my crochet journey, started teaching classes at another yarn store, and then eventually started working at that yarn store, and then sort of found that there were a lot of things that could be done better, is what I sort of observed, but the owners weren't really up for friendly suggestions. short story. Just went and started off doing it on my own.
Good on you, that's brave. And so what year did you open?
2017, I believe.
Okay, yeah, and I actually visited at your original store, which was across the road.
Yes,
and
so when did you? Smaller store.
Yes, so we'll include some footage of Emily's store, but it's a beautiful big yarn store with lots and lots of space for lots and lots of yarn.
Yes.
And so when did you move across the road?
It would have been a bit over a year. So we had a year-long lease just to test it out and see if it worked or if it didn't work, which was a nice little testing ground for it. And then, quickly found that we needed a bigger space and a longer-term plan. So conveniently, we just ended up moving across the road, which was a very easy move.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, been here ever since. And that was yeah, the shop, yeah, it's been about 5 years now, so
fantastic. And owning a yarn store sounds like it would be just days filled with knitting in the corner while you're waiting for customers and lots of squishy yarn, but I'm guessing it's...
That's the dream. it's a lot more work than that. Very occasionally, probably once a month, I reckon, I get to knit in the shop myself. The girls who run it now, I've got a wonderful team of staff. They're amazing. I don't know what I'd do without them. They get a little bit of knitting done. But yes, it's endless bookwork and ordering of stock and planning months ahead for various seasons. What samples are we going to have? Which is very fun. It's a very fun thing to plan that. But sourcing different yarns, what do we need? And yeah, just a lot of admin. Some of it fun, some of it not so fun.
And do you have a particular ethos or something that you work with when you're designing your range, or how do you make those really important ranging decisions?
Well, I did a bit of design work before opening the store and have sort of picked it up again since having the shop as really a tool to help fill gaps in the pattern world that we've found from having the shop and having customers. So often it will be like, we're getting asked a lot about an 8-ply jumper that's suitable for complete beginners. Surprisingly hard to find. One that looks tasteful, is done in the round and has clear instructions. Really tricky to find. So that's where the real easy bag one came in.
Which we will talk about later in the episode.
The lovely pattern, gotta say. It's been very, very helpful in the shop. So it's really just like, we need a basic beanie. We need a basic sock. We need a basic garment. Like, and it's over the years, it's just been sort of adding that in slowly, slowly, just really filling that need for beginners and going, here's something reliable that we know and you're going to love it and have fun with it. And
did you have to do a bit of study or training to work that out? Or
unfortunately, in the knitting design world, there's not that available. Okay. Yeah, there's books, plenty of books, some online courses, but they're very specialized, very specific, and there's a whole bunch of different ways to do it, and it's usually industry experience or just sheer working it out. So
well done.
I ended up with the sheer working it out part.
I'm definitely not at that sheer working out stage.
It's been fun.
And so when you're picking what yarn, so we'll, as I said, we'll include some more footage of Emily's store, but it's a lovely mix of lots of smaller hand dyed, a lot of local dyers that you support. I mean, we're very lucky in Australia and particularly in Victoria that there are a lot of really beautiful local dyers.
So right. Yeah.
But then you've also got like a lovely range of affordable yarns. How do you, and not many big brands. So how do you make those sort of decisions?
That was one of the reasons why I opened the store. I personally love local yarns. I knew a lot of people who also love local yarns. And I couldn't find anywhere to actually go and see them in person without just going online or visiting them somewhere rurally directly or at once a year markets or things like that. So that was another reason to go, okay, this is lacking. I think this would be a great thing to showcase. Just getting in touch with a bunch of people early on that I knew of already, but lots of dyers and other companies have gotten in touch with us over the years as we've got more known. There's so many fantastic Australian and New Zealand yarns out there, and it's just a matter of finding them all and bringing them in. And of course we can't fit all of them, which would just be an absolute dream. So we're getting there slowly, getting creative with making space to fit more and more in.
Yeah, well, you definitely have a lovely creative space here. And so I noticed that you're wearing a really beautiful handmade top today. Can you tell us about that?
So this is another one of my patterns. I think it was the start of 2022. I think what the date is now. We released the Tip Top Tank pattern as a nice summer, very beginner friendly, easy summer knit. And this is a version that I've done with adding some bow tie sleeves.
That's super cute.
Which is very fun. I will eventually update the pattern with that. I haven't got around to it yet. But the yarn for this is the BC Garn Soft Silk, and I'm just loving the texture of it. Got a skein.
Yeah. Handy.
Yeah, do I know? Prepared earlier. And it's a 100% barrette silk yarn, which just means it's the more textural part of the silk cocoon rather than the super, super fine, slinky silk that we sort of know of or think of when we think of silk. You have a feel.
Ah, so it is quite... There is that little bit of, and even that little bit of slight grippiness that you get. I had silkworms as a kid.
Oh,
so,
did you?
Yeah.
So that's that grippy texture you can feel would be the silk glue that sort of holds the cocoon together. And that does wash out when you block it.
Okay.
And then it just softens up into this beautifully, here's the flat you can feel. Just a really drapey but light fabric with a lovely gloss and kind of a slubby texture.
It looks absolutely stunning.
Delightful to wear. It's so soft. So I'm just really loving this yarn.
Well, that's a good segue into talking about some of the other things that you're really excited with working. Mm. We talked about how it's too hard to have a favorite.
A little bit hard to have a favorite yarn when you own a yarn store. So currently, given it's still very, very hot in Melbourne and will be for at least another month or so.
We hope.
Probably.
Maybe.
Pretty likely. Yeah. It's really hot today. So, but we have some beautiful summer yarns that I'm just really loving at the moment. So we have... again, another BC Garn. We have BC Garn Alino, which is a cotton and linen yarn, which it's just, again, a really interesting texture. I think that's what I'm loving about these summer fibres, is they're just all a bit unique and a bit special, and they behave really differently when you block them. So it's sort of like this nice journey that you go in on the whole process.
And these are really gorgeous because it looks like, is it the linen versus the cotton that picks up colour slightly differently?
Yeah. The colours almost get this nice little twisted stripe through it as the fibres take the dye differently. I believe that's how it works. I'm not a dyer myself. but just, again, light, drapey, but not heavy, just interesting textures. And this other one is a Kremke Reborn Denim, which is a recycled cotton from old denim jeans.
Oh, wow.
So they've gone and done a bit more of a sustainable yarn. They've got a good focus on it, this brand does, on taking old waste denim clothing, chopping them up, spinning them into a yarn, and then dyeing them in beautiful colours. And again, it's another slubby textural yarn. You've got all these lovely little flecks of colour in there that you get from... like they've got the threads still in from the seams and the labels that have all been chopped up in there. So these, again, are the fibres that just pick up the dye really differently.
Wow, they're fantastic. So,
just another fun experience. Yeah.
What else have you got to show us?
So some of our other more recent acquisitions. Got to put in some hand-dyed yarn, given we have so many lovely dyers. we have these beautiful sock yarns from Obsession Yarn, and she's got these fun assigned pooling colors which sort of just create all sorts of fun little different pockets of color as you knit them depending on what you're knitting, whether it's shawls or socks or garments. But her base is just soft and squishy, and it's just really nice to have some colors that are fresh and different.
Gayanne and I have been lusting over this brand online for a while, but never seen it in real life before.
Exactly.
It's very exciting. And the assigned pooling thing's a bit of a trend at the moment,
it
isn't
is,
it?
Very much so.
Dawn Barker, was it, in America, I think, started the trend. And she has some patterns where she really focuses on the assigned pooling. Mm-hmm. I'm working on a project at the moment that I'll show in another episode that's talking about that. But these are just such glorious. And Obsession Yarns, is she in...
She's in Canberra. Canberra gal. Marie. Hello, Marie. she's really nice. She popped into the store one day. This is, again, another dyer who we didn't know of because she's a bit newer on the scene. Came into our store when she was visiting Melbourne and introduced herself to us. And we couldn't be happier to this. We had two of them in the same week, one from Canberra, one from New South Wales. And we're just like, amazing, all these fun new products we can get.
Oh, that's fabulous.
Yeah, yeah. And yeah, she's just super nice too. So this color range that we have, we just went, too hard to choose colors, just put something together for us that you think you'll love. And yeah, she hit the nail on the head, really.
Oh,
yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And then lastly, one of my other long-term favorites is Prosper Yarns. Les is this wonderful, originally American woman who's been living in New Zealand for quite a while. And she's just a hoot. And she again reached out to us one day and said, hey, I'm coming to Melbourne. How about we organize a trunk show? I think your shop's cool. And we're so glad she did, because she brought all these beautiful, beautiful bags of yarn, and we just had her in for the weekend. This was probably 3 years ago now, I want to say. But she's got so many lovely bases. So we've just recently got her new Superwash DK base, which is just lush and squishy and silky smooth. And it pairs beautifully with her mohair, the Prosper Mint, which is just... oh, it's so soft. Just have a feel of those.
Oh, they are lovely. I mean, I definitely have had a squish of these on previous visits to the store. Yeah. But yeah.
My love of mohair hasn't died yet.
Hopefully it never will.
Yeah,
hopefully this current trend of using it with everything never will die. And so we have to ask, do you have a few... maybe favorite is the wrong word to use again, but a few designers that you're really loving at the moment?
Yeah, I've got a few projects lined up in the queue. There's always too many things to knit, but I think my next one that I'm eyeing off for cooler weather is Sari Nordland's Foxberry sweater. It's a beautiful lace yoked pattern, and she's just got such a nice design aesthetic, which speaks to me. And again, I'm going to use a four ply with a mohair, make it nice and fluffy, because I can't have enough mohair jumpers at the moment, apparently. But just the shape, her silhouette just is really nice. It's good.
And I've seen from following you on Instagram over the years, you do quite a lot of lace work in your knitting, don't you?
Not so much these days, because I'm a time poor businesswoman and my brain's always full of other stuff. So pretty much 90% of the things I make are like a stocking stitch, real plain. But I do like them to have a little bit of something at the yoke to keep it interesting. So we'll see. I haven't had the brain space to start it yet, but hopefully soon. And then the other things grabbing me currently, is my friend all the way over in London, Eugenie Giroux. I hope I'm pronouncing your surname correctly, Eugenie. But she's recently been designing and just has a really fresh, young, modern aesthetic to her designs. And I find them really inspiring. They're very fun. So her off-piste sweater, I'm really looking forward to making it. It's this nice bat wing, which is just a great look. I love it. And with a big cable panel down the front. So again, mostly simple knitting, but with a bit of interest, which really fits with my life and my knitting capacity currently.
And this Eugenie was a designer that we hadn't heard of before. Mm. So has she just fairly recently started designing? Or
maybe only over the last year or two. She works in a yarn store over in the UK at the moment. I can't remember the name of it off the top of my head, but I think that's helped boost her in the yarny scene. She used to come along and when she was living in Melbourne for a little while, she used to come along and visit us pretty regularly for our sit and knit group over in the small shop. So I miss seeing her, and she just popped up on my Instagram a little while ago, and it's like, she's designing. Fantastic. But yeah, really worth checking out, which has got very fun designs.
Very, very fun designs. I was very happy to discover her through you.
And then lastly, I'd also like to give a shout out to Susanna Kartanen. I hope I haven't butchered your surname. I have a weird surname too, it's fine. And she's a Finnish girl living in Victoria. I don't know how close she is to Melbourne, but I've met her a few times and she's just so nice. But she's also been designing some really nice, modern, but classic pieces recently. I think she's been designing for three, four years, something like that.
Yep.
But yeah, she's been featured in a couple of magazines recently. I think she was in Making and possibly Laying magazine as well. But some of her designs just really worth checking out. Very, very classy, very elegant, but modern and fun too.
So. Absolutely. And she's also involved in wool production as well.
I believe so. I need to have a chat to her about that again recently. But she first got in contact with me many years ago with having sheep on a farm and working out what to do with the yarn.
Right. Fascinating. That's really exciting.
Might need to talk to her next.
Yeah, well. We would love to ask your opinion or guidance, I guess, on substituting yarns. I suspect you're a bit of an expert on it because, as we mentioned before, your store's full of like little local dyers and brands that you don't see everywhere else.
Yeah.
As a bit of a demo piece, Gayanne's brought in a project that she made, which is the Cloaked in Clouds poncho by Two of Wands, which is a gorgeous pattern. But the yarn that she used was different than the original, and it's quite a bit bigger than she was anticipating.
Yes, we over years, because I've been in the industry probably for about 8 years working in yarn stores, have encountered this quite a lot, unsurprisingly. So with substituting yarns, especially because we're in Australia, away from American yarns, European yarns, they're a little bit harder to get. We don't have as big a design community here. Yes, it's very, very needed that we substitute yarns. It just gets expensive to buy the same yarns that are in the pattern quite often. So the first thing I would recommend is to swatch. Swatching is your friend. I'm sorry to those people who don't like swatching, but it is just going to be such a helpful thing to do in so many situations, like picking a size, making sure you've got the right gauge of your pattern, whether it's the yarn texture is different, whether the fibre content is different, whether your own personal tension just varies, like from mood even.
And do you also suggest soaking it, like blocking?
Quite often. Yep. If it's a fibre that you're quite used to working with, say like a standard sort of superwash wool or non-superwash merino, that's not likely to change too much with washing, then you can sort of get away with it. But if it's a different texture, like some of the summer yarns we mentioned earlier, which just transform completely when they get exposed to water, then yes, it's definitely a good idea to block your swatch as well. Treat it how you would treat it with washing in future, because that way when you wash it in future, it's not going to change. So swatching will give you a lot of information, whether that's you want it to be a lighter texture, whether you want it to be a denser texture. Even if your yarn is a little bit different, you still might get a lovely result, but it'll give you more information to base that decision on. So with fibre content differences, you will get a lot of differences in the fabric that you're creating. So if your original pattern asks for a wool and you might be in a warmer climate and you want to substitute it with a summer yarn, like a cotton or a linen, then those are other things to factor in when substituting yarns. So cottons or alpacas or things tend to drape a lot more. So with larger garments, it can be advised. You've just got to think about it a little bit more, because with a bigger amount of fabric, you'll get a bit more stretch because the whole weight is bigger. So often I recommend customers will pick a larger garment where the pattern has seams, because they'll give a bit more structure, or just a firmer gauge. The more loose your gauge is, the more likely it is to stretch out, because it doesn't hold quite as much structure. But in Gayanne's case, we've looked at the yarns and it confusingly is what we'd think would be a lighter fabric. She's used a wool and mohair blend, which is often quite airy. So it could well be a a difference in the like the gauge as she's knit it. So with bigger projects like longer line cardigans or blankets or things, you might find a difference in your tension as you knit along. Just as there's more weight on the needles, your stitches might stretch out a bit more than they normally would. So just, it's a good idea to check your tension partway through the knitting, and you might need to size down a needle or size up a needle if your tension has gotten tighter as well. Just to make those adjustments to account for the extra weight.
So when sizing down or sizing up, in terms of, we mostly talk in Australia often about millimetres of needles rather than specific needle sizes. What sort of changes would you?
With something like that, it's going to be a fairly small change most likely. So you just go down half a centimetre.
Millimetre.
Don't go half a centimetre.
Multiple centimetres.
That is a bad idea.
That would be.
Yeah. Just like the next size down. So if you're on a 4.5, go down to a 4 or a 3.5. Just use a bit of intuition. Use your brain a little bit. See how drastically it might change. And like a way to check if your gauge is different is to just set your fabric down, get out a tape measure and count your stitches. Is the gauge on this current fabric different to when it started at the beginning?
Thank you. Those are some really helpful tips. Mm-hmm. And maybe you've convinced me to start swatching.
Swatching is good. It's also just a fun way to test out like, oh, I really like this fabric. Like maybe I can do something with this in future, even if it's not suitable to what I had intended it for originally. I suppose the other thing as well with yarn substitutions is knowing what thickness of yarn the original yarn might have been. A lot of European yarns will use a completely different system to what we do, and it can be quite hard to tell. Or also yarns might be just given a different thickness to how we would grade them in Australia. So different countries will use they'll call an 8-ply one thing and we'll call an 8-ply another thing. So.
And I think we are the only country that really focus on ply in terms of
where ply isn't just how many strands of yarn there is, where in Europe and Icelandic areas as well and patterns, they'll use ply to mean the actual number of strands in yarn. So it's completely different and can be really confusing when you start.
Very confusing.
Yeah. So what I would really focus on again is gauge. So gauge will give you the number of stitches to 10 centimeters or 4 inches, depending on where you are. And that will really start to inform you of like, okay, this is a 20 stitch fabric that they're asking for. Maybe I'll go an 8-ply because I know that other project I used had the same amount of stitches. And it's hard to know as a beginner, if you're newer to these things, it takes a long time. Like I've been doing this for a long time now and I can just go, oh yeah, that's this thickness. Oh, that, try this one. It'll go for that 14 stitches or 22 stitches. It just sort of,
which is why it's helpful to come into a store where people have that expertise.
That's right.
To give you the guidance.
Yes.
So if you do visit Maker Maker, make sure that you talk to the very experienced, lovely staff here.
We love questions.
Because they're very, very good at sorting out all of your problems.
It's something that we really love to do. So like anytime someone comes in with a project, they're like, I don't know what I'm doing. What do I use? Like, hey, just let us know. We'll take care of it. Or go to your local yarn store if you're not nearby to us.
We have a bit of show and tell as well today. So Emily's brought along a couple of things that your couple of works in
just
progress.
Current works
or,
in progress.
Yeah.
Progress.
We love a work in progress.
So at the moment, it took me a while, but I finally found the design I wanted to use my Christmas advent for. I'm not usually an advent girl. I know you guys have been having a bit of fun opening all of your lovely mini skeins. But this year, Christmas just gone. We collaborated with the lovely Pauline from Melbourne City Dyeworks, and she's created a custom colour range for our advent calendar this year. So that was a very exciting process.
That's
just getting to go back and forth with going, ooh, what colours do we want? And sort of finding some inspiration and watching it come to life has been very exciting. So I treated myself. How could I not pick an advent which I've helped put together? So I have just started, it's not very far along. I wish I'd got a bit more done, but I've just started the, thank you, Imagine, it's just called the Imagine Sweater by Emily Louise, who's a, I believe, a French pattern writer, and just a really nice, simple top-down raglan. It's got a bit of a saddle shoulder in the shaping, which you probably can't see from here, but I'm going to just stripe the middle section of it with my lovely Advent minis. We'll probably pop a photo in of the colours if I haven't got them all with me, but just keeping it nice and bright and fun with that one.
It's super gorgeous yarn. Yeah. Really, so lovely.
The top colour I've
very, used. Very maker-maker colours.
Oh yeah, very maker-maker. I went a bit not so bright for a while and now I'm like, nah, I need some bright colourful knits again. So this top yarn I've used is a bit different to Pauline's 8-ply base. I've just used some of our Prosper DK Superwash, which is just, oh my god, it's so yummy. It's so squishy.
And I also have,
because I can't stay away from this silk yarn, I have a soft silk Anchors sweater, Anchors tee from Petite Knit. So it's got that lovely, nice, simple rib texture, which just shows off so nicely the textural silk yarn. In a lovely green. This is actually for my mum.
Oh, how lovely.
It was her birthday in December, so I started it, I think, on her birthday. So she's not expecting it yet.
No, but, she might.
Yes. And I would highly recommend that pattern for any newer garment knitters. It's really easy. It's one of the ones that I just think is clearly written. Getting that nice satisfaction through the yoke, it's actually really easy to do, and then the rest is nice and plain. And then just short sleeves for the t-shirt version, which is great. So very newbie friendly.
And then after that,
my last one doesn't look very exciting at the moment, but I'm just doing another ripple crop top, I believe, from Jessie Made in our 4-ply organic cotton, the BC Garn Alba. And it's just stretchy and soft and looks like just a bit of a tube at the moment, but it will be a t-shirt with a v-neck. And I'm looking forward to wearing it when it's done. Yeah, super fun.
Thank you for bringing those in.
No worries.
And with Purlfect Pairings, one of the things we like to do is pair, well, often wine or cocktails or other drinks, non-alcoholic drinks as well. Mm-hmm. With various projects. Do you have a favourite thing to drink either while knitting or not while knitting?
Around
knitting time.
Usually in winter, I'm a strict peppermint or chamomile tea drinker. Give me herbal teas and I'm very happy. Very nice and relaxing with a nice cozy knit. But in the summer months, I don't mind a bit of a gin and tonic, a bit of a mojito girl. Sorry, I'm not a wine drinker.
That's all right. That's all right. But,
so give me the cocktails and I'm pretty happy.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for your time, Emily. It's been an absolute delight. And we'll make sure that we include all of the Maker Maker details. Definitely a must stop in if you're ever in Melbourne or if you live locally. And come and visit Emily and her beautiful star.
Thank you. And welcome back to my lounge room.
Wasn't that fun?
Super fun.
Oh, field trips to yarn shops.
Yes. And we have had, as you can see, a little outfit change.
Yes.
So we thought today was a good time to twin in our real easy raglan sweaters, which was designed by Emily at Maker Maker. It was a pattern that she released quite a little while ago, but it's a really actually I think it might have been about 2 years ago. I think it was quite a recent release when I discovered it. And it's a fabulous first sweater project.
So good. It's a free pattern that's available from the Maker Maker website. And I love this sweater. I just love it.
They fit beautifully. The instructions for this pattern are so clear and easy to follow. It's a top down. Once you've done a top down sweater, you'll never go back.
I feel like there's no going back.
There's no going back. You can try it on, and it, within the pattern, Emily actually gives you instructions for trying it on, and how to do the sizing.
So we're laughing because Ted, I have a dog as well at home named Murphy, and Ted is rifling through the bags of things that I brought today, which probably smell very much like Murphy. It's actually hysterical, but not that great for filming.
Not brilliant. It is a 35 degree day
it
outside
is.
Here. So normally Ted would be banished outside for filming,
but not today.
Today he's just going to participate.
It's too hot to be hot to be in the garden.
Yeah. So let's talk about our lovely jumpers in this 33 degree
your
day.
It's color.
Already becoming quite warm.
I know. It is a bit warm, but that's okay. We'll keep going. Your color
is fabulous.
Oh my God. Yeah. I love it.
This yarn is actually, there's a really quite a large producer of yarn locally in Victoria called Bendigo Woolen Mills. And this is one of their yarns, which is a 50% wool, 50% bamboo yarn. It's actually, unfortunately, a discontinued yarn. It was from a few years ago. It's an 8-ply called Galaxy, and this is the wild berry color. I feel like it's quite almost that, like 2023 on-trend magenta.
It's gorgeous.
Maybe a bit pinker, but.
And I don't know if you can really see it, but it's kind of got a, not a heather to it, but there's certainly like a bit of light and pink, light pink, lighter and darker. It's not variegated, but there's a bit of just interest and depth in the color.
Possibly, again, due to the way maybe the wool and the bamboo pick up the color.
Yeah, they pick up the dye.
So
mine is a Rowan yarn, their alpaca soft DK. It's very soft.
So soft.
So soft. This is shade 204. It's a brown sweater that I made for my husband. It's actually my husband's sweater, which I thankfully fit into. It's nice and roomy and oversized. Do you want to stand up so they can see the bottom of it? Because mine is a bit longer, but it's just a fabulous basic top down, literally easiest to follow pattern I think I've ever knit.
Yep. With, as I was saying before Ted interrupted us, with some really lovely clear instructions on how to try it on as you're going, how to adjust the sizing, even options for reduce, like cutting in a little bit once you get past the bust line.
The neck shaping as well. So do you have neck shaping in yours? Did you put that in?
I can't remember if I did.
I've got it on this only because I wanted Larry to be able to distinguish from the front and the back. And I just think it looks nicer. It will sit a bit higher up in the back of the neck, a bit warmer.
Really fabulous pattern. And actually a real joy to knit because it does knit up quite quickly. It's the sort of pattern that I would happily make again and again, I think.
Absolutely. And then if you get adventurous, you could put your own, I guess, kind of stamp on it. So if you wanted to do the body in a different stitch pattern, I think this is a great bouncing point from that.
Yeah,
or if
absolutely.
You wanted to do the sleeve in a different stitch pattern or put a a panel of lace or cable down the sleeve. It would be really easy to
customize.
Zhuzh it.
Zhuzh. I like that better than customize.
Zhuzh your sweaters.
And we have talked about a pairing for this one. And look, given that it's a first sweater project, I think the pairing might be better off being a tee. But there's one that we really want to talk about. And through the magic of film, I've just zipped across the other side of the room and picked up the tea that we forgot to have close to us as we started filming. So the tea that we want to pair with this project is by Mariage Frere, which is a French brand of tea. My partner introduced me to it. He keeps buying it for me, which I have no concerns about whatsoever.
No complaining.
And it's all of the tea is really gorgeous, but I particularly like this one. It's called Alexandra David Nial, and it's a spicy and fruity tea for adventurers. So it's a bit like a, would you say like a chai?
It's spicy like a chai. I find it has a lot of, now I didn't actually Google what is in this tea or look at the ingredients, but when I make it, I get quite a bit of white pepper.
I think it's got pepper in it. I did actually Google.
Yay, one of us is prepared.
Ginger, cinnamon, and cardamom, and something a bit fruity as well, which I couldn't find reference to. I think they keep their exact recipes a little bit secret. So.
Mm-hmm. So it is very much like a chai.
Yeah, very much like a
chai. Like chai light, I think. We can get it, oh my gosh, what's the name of the macaron shop?
La Belle Miette.
Yes.
Delicious macaron shop in Melbourne. But it is internationally available, so I would check out your local tea supplier. Highly, highly recommend their teas, particularly this one.
Yes. Great, another outfit change.
Yes, hot off the needles.
Oh. Like literally.
So hot. Red hot.
Red hot. We're talking like 10 o'clock last night. I finished the I-cord. So this is a crescent shaped shawl. I spoke about it in our first episode called the Mautinoa by a designer out of Amsterdam, Malia May. She's the, as I understand, the co-owner of Stephen and Penelope. This pattern was part of the Stephen and Penelope / Westnitz yarn along for 2022. It's actually the only shawl of the three that I finished in 2022. Well, actually, I didn't even finish it in 2022. Anyway, close enough.
Close enough.
Close enough. It was the first crescent-shaped shawl that I made. It's quite narrow. It's not that deep, but it's very long. But it's also glorious. I'll take it off
the weekend. Truly glorious.
We might even have to stand up. It's literally longer than this, than the couch that we are sitting on.
It starts with and this garter tab up here, and then it moves to a tuck stitch. Then these crisscross stitches. Oh, sorry, this is a slip stitch pattern. Crisscross, tuck stitch, centipede, more crisscross arrows, another tuck stitch section, and then this unbelievable I-cord bind off, which is about 6 stitches wide.
Yep, quite a wide bind off. We've just been talking about it. At the moment it looks very wide, but I think once it's blocked it will.
Yes, it's not blocked. I still haven't sewn in the edges.
And it is fresh off the needles.
These are my leftovers. So these are the colors. There were 2 Life in the Long Grass merino singles, the color Pollinate, and the color Parchment. Sorry, Nicole, I'm just trying to. That's not happening. I think we both have to be. There we go. There it is. It was there for a minute. Anyway. Then these 2 amazing colors were Essence of Autumn, their Zephyr base in Red Hot. No, what if we do that? There we go. Red Hot and Firecracker. Whoops. No. Anyway, that's Firecracker.
my mother's.
We're vain. We're filming in cinematic mode on the iPhone because it makes us look better. It doesn't necessarily show you the yarn as well as it could. So we apologize for that.
Yes, vanity especially, is important. Right, especially my mother who tells me every time I hold the yarn up to the camera, it's fuzzy. Sorry, Mom.
The other thing we wanted to show you, because these are glorious hand-dyed yarns, mm-hmm. is, so I had the same kit. As you can tell, I'm nowhere near as advanced as Gayanne. I got distracted with a number of other projects. But there is quite a lot of, I think, really delightful difference between different balls. So obviously for this, you're just using one skein of each. There's no issue with having to match up colorways or anything mm-hmm. like you might in a sweater. So it doesn't matter that they are different. Mm-hmm. But as we were spinning them, I think you actually came over here, we were spinning them together, and we were marveling at the quite distinct color differences. So this is the
Red Hot.
So mine is perhaps just at this part of my ball, but a little bit more red. And then in the, is it Pollinate?
This one with the greens in it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gayanne's got a lot more color in hers than in mine.
Oh, yours is actually a lot beigier.
Yeah.
Where mine is a bit more off-white. It's interesting because my mom also has this kit from the yarn along, and her firecracker was substantially different than mine as well. And indeed, by the time this recording comes out, you will be able to purchase the Mautinoa kit from Stephen and Penelope. They announced on Instagram that they were releasing the kits, I think, on the 6th of January.
It's a delightful shawl.
It's a delightful
it's
shawl.
It's a lot of work.
Buckle up. I don't know. If you knit, I've probably knit in the last week the amount that I would normally knit in a month, if I broke it down to hours. But I knew that if I didn't, and then I started back up at work, I wouldn't have the time. Mm. Like, it would take another 2 months for me to finish this, realistically.
600 stitches at the widest point?
667, and then you cast on five more stitches for the high cord.
Yep.
Bind off.
Which is a six stitch, did you say? Six stitch high cord bind
off? It was.
Yeah.
It was.
It's an undertaking. A beautiful, beautiful undertaking.
And I think later in the week it's only going to be a high of about 20 here, so I might get to take it for a spin.
Definitely worth blocking.
I'll block it tonight. Yeah. I'll block it tonight.
Amazing.
The Mautinoa.
Ta-da.
Look at this.
So beautiful.
Ah. All right. You also have a beautiful finished object.
I do. And I'm wearing it.
Yes.
Did you see me going to look for it? I do. It's over here. Oh no, it's on me. So I have let me just prop myself up a little bit more, my lovely woolen pine summer sorrel.
It's gorgeous.
So woolen pine is the designer. There is a number of different sorrels. There's a sorrel, I think, and mm-hmm. then a spring sorrel, and then this is the summer one. So shorter sleeves, and I think there's a little bit of modification in the bodywork as well. I haven't done the other one, so I'm not quite sure what the differences are, but I am absolutely in love with it. It is super comfortable to wear. I'll just do a little spin for the camera. And I knitted it up in a lovely yarn that I talked about last episode one, I think, that my partner brought back from Singapore for me. So it's kaiju fibers, and it's got three different colorways. So the pattern's actually really excellent the way it describes how to fade. And I actually learned a lot in doing it about where you start fades in order to give you a flattering line. So they recommend that you start the second fade before the bust line to give you a more flattering line. And to make sure that the bust line, I'll just do a little prop up there, that the bust line is all in the one color. And then also there's some really lovely instructions on the best way to fade in new colours in terms of what rows to do. So it has been a really, really joyful knit. And the colourways I've got, so I've got Spring Butterfly at the top, which is these lovely pinks and blues and kind of whites and pale greys. Then I've got silver in the middle, and then down the bottom I've got denim colour and a bit of yarn left over of each of those as well. So
fabulous.
I might make some other sort of little garment or hat or something.
I know, I'll have to do maybe an episode on some of our favourite scrappy projects. Oh. I've seen quite a few vlogs that come out, especially around this time of year, about using small amounts like advents and scraps and things. It's always fun.
We are big collectors of scrappy projects.
We are. Yes. If you have a favorite scrappy project, why don't you leave us a comment so we can start compiling those, and maybe we'll do a whole episode on scrappy projects.
Mm. And I wanted to do a wine pairing with this one. So
celebratory.
Right? Celebratory, yeah. I mean, a lot of this, once you get past the top part, which you do need to focus on a little bit, a lot of it is just lovely, fairly easy kind of knitting.
Is it just garter stitch?
It is. Well,
Do you flip it inside out?
Yes, it's very nicely designed for you to knit up quite quickly. So once you get past the top part and all the dip stitches that form these lovely rows, then you actually are able to flip the project in the round so that you can just knit away, and it gives you that lovely garter stitch look without having to do a lot of purling, which is exactly my kind of vibe. And so to pair with this top, because once you do get to the body of it, it is quite an easy knit. I wanted to bring along a wine that I've tried recently, which is the Chalmers Vermentino. So a couple of interesting things about this. Chalmers is a family-owned winery that is very influential in Australia in terms of bringing in Italian varieties. So they have a big vine nursery. I think it's up in Mildura, which is Western Victoria, where they bring in and are responsible for bringing in a lot of Italian varietals. So traditionally in Australia, we planted a lot of French varietals, Chardonnay, Pinot Noir, Cabernet, Riesling. Riesling's German, but not always super suited to our warmer climate, whereas the Italian varietals are. So this is a Vermentino. You can see the lovely silvery label, goldy label, that doesn't necessarily show. There'll be notes about this, obviously. And it's from Heathcote. So this is, Heathcote's about,
it's not too far out of Melbourne. Maybe about an hour?
Probably closer to 2 hours. Quite close to Bendigo, which is where we about the woolen mill is. And if you haven't come across the grape variety Vermentino before, highly recommend it as a summer drink. It's a really vibrant, crispy, crunchy, fresh, high acid sort of variety. So think I guess a bit like a Pinot Grigio, but with a little bit more citrusy flavors than Pinot Grigio often has. This one, a big fan of. So it's got like these lovely crunchy, nashy pear kind of flavors, lots of lemon zest, lots of white peaches, like white stone fruit kind of characters. And then quite a lovely sort of savory edge to it, almost like a salad vegetable, more like a cucumber or something like that. Oh. So think about how refreshing cucumber flavors are in a gin and tonic. That's the vibe.
It sounds like a very balanced wine.
Yeah,
between super, that fruit, not too fruity, not too savory.
Yep.
Unchallenging. I would probably like it.
Yep, really, really good with food as well. And one of the really exciting things with these Italian varietals is they often have a little bit, they're known for having a bit more texture. And texture in wine is a really strange thing, right? Do you understand What's your understanding of texture?
I go by kind of like mouthfeel.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's the same thing as texture, but just like how smooth it feels in my mouth.
Yeah.
And like where I can taste it like on my tongue.
Yeah. And I mean, I think that's a good explanation of it. So in order to understand texture in wine, sometimes it's really good to go back to texture in food. So probably the best way for me to describe the texture of this one is when you do bite into a really lovely fresh cucumber, you know how you kind of get that it's cooling, but it's kind of, there is just that little bit of kind of slight grippiness of the cellulose or the cells of the...
Yes, yeah, so it would, like you crunch through and then you get the bit of this firmer part of the fruit of the cucumber, and then you have the seeds that kind of your teeth would go straight through.
Yep.
So
it has that lovely, a lot more mouthfeel, visceral sensations in your mouth compared to some other wines that feel a little bit more watery or slippery. So Vermentino is a variety that I'm really loving for summer, and can highly recommend this lovely one from Chalmers.
All right, now what's on our needles? What are we currently knitting? I've got a few projects on the go, but the one I want to talk about today is my half and half triangles wrap. I'm talking about it because I want to get a little bit more motivation to keep going with it. You know, sometimes you get these projects and you start and you're all excited about them, and then you're like, oh, that's a lot of knitting. Golly. Anyway, sorry, Mom. So here it is. I'm making the larger version, so I think it's like 260 stitches. It's a free pattern, so there's no giving anything away, really. It's a Pearl Soho pattern, if you haven't heard about it. It's been all over Instagram, the knitting community. Katie Jacks did a half and half knit along, I think last year. Well, definitely last year, now that it's
2023.
Yay! And I have decided to make this in Holst Super Soft, which is a really affordable option even when you get it delivered from Denmark. It uses a lot of yarn. This color is called Poppy. And I'm going to do the other half in the color called Scots Pine, which, can we hold that up? Will that do that? No.
Nope.
It's okay.
You just love holding it in front of my face.
Yes, there you go. Maybe it would do it now. Anyway. So I've gotten up to here, my stitch marker here with the short rows, but I still have that much left to go. It's quite a bit of knitting. So it'll be an ongoing project that I will share with you. Maybe once I get the Scots Pine attached, because I think that's the kind of next thing. Modifications, I'm doing the Amy Palko modifications. I'm doing German short rows instead of wrap and turns. And I'm slipping the last stitch with yarn in front to create a smoother edge along the other.
Instead of just like a knit stitch.
Yeah, the garter. It would otherwise have garter bumps. And the other thing that is fun about this project, I'm knitting it on the 3.25 millimeter needles, but my needles are from a Japanese company called Kinki Amabari, or I think they're sold under the banner of C Knit. That's S-E-E-K-N-I-T. And they're a beautiful Japanese needle that I found on Etsy. They're bamboo.
Because you are always trying to find a more sustainable, ethical...
That's right. I worry that my hobby is impacting the lives of people who are making the tools that I use to have fun with. So I'm fairly confident that the labor laws in Japan would mean that their workers would have you know, decent wages and good working conditions. So I'm very happy to support that. And I tend to really look for sustainability statements. I know that KnitPro has a video on their website highlighting the conditions for their factory and where things are made. So I feel pretty comfortable buying KnitPro as well, which is the other needle that I use predominantly. My mom sent me a few other ones, but I think they're made in Germany as well. So happy with that, because I think the conditions in Germany would also be fairly good for workers.
And it can be quite hard to find transparency statements. I know that since I met you, I'm much more conscious of looking for those transparency statements every time I'm particularly buying shoes, or and it can be quite challenging.
It can be. So, and I'm not saying that other companies those needles are not
ethical. But knitting companies, please put transparency statements on your website.
We would love that.
It makes shopping much easier for us.
I'd feel much more confident, I could just see that.
Absolutely. Well, on my needles. So after our last little episode 2, we were talking about summer solstice cast on that didn't, because I realized I didn't have the needle size that I needed to cast on my poor Klee sweater. But I had a couple of days off over Christmas and made some pretty good progress.
Oh my gosh. Sorry, this is the first time I'm seeing this. And
pretty good progress
on
the poor
Klee. I'm so excited for that.
So this is where I'm up to so far. I'll do one of these little zoom in situations where
I hide my face?
Guarantee.
Can we hear
it?
We're good.
Let there me pop it in front of your face. There we go. I'm definitely going to make this shot our starting shot on YouTube. Just the
perfect. And it's beautiful.
So there we go.
Okay. How did you pick your color? Because I still have 90 stitches of the 111 stitches cast on, and I haven't gone back to it because I can't decide how to line up my colors.
So I'm going to pop a picture on Instagram of how I decided my colors, but I believe a quick decision is a good decision. So I lay them out on the floor. I popped my main color, which is chiffon, at the top and at the bottom. And then I just whacked colors next to each other that I thought went well and left it at that. And look, as I'm knitting, sometimes I'm like, ooh, I'm not sure about, you know, where we're going, but I just run with it. Because, you know, in my day job, which is in healthcare, when people make mistakes, very, very bad stuff happens. People die. And nothing ever happens like that when I'm knitting. Even if my color choices aren't good, I don't believe. I mean, it might be one of those butterfly effects where a poor color choice now leads to a natural disaster in another country, but I feel like that's not going to be the case.
I think the odds of that happening are highly unlikely.
So that is where I'm at. I'm currently using, I'm actually very happy with my current row.
Ooh.
So I've got
these
two lovely colors. I've got tiny little hands. Let me try and hold them up for you. So we've got Calypso and Heath.
Fabulous.
Let me just pop them in front of your face. There we go.
In fact, I think Heath is the same color as my eyes. So you just pop that.
So they're, I've just started the row of that. But it is such a fun project. I'm really enjoying knitting it. The Holst Super Soft yarn, it should be said at this point, is not super soft. It's quite crunchy to work with. But in some ways that's good, because it does give you clear stitch definition, and it's very hard to drop a stitch when you're using a crunchy yarn, I'm finding.
Have you done a color work?
Rip.
Oh, sorry.
No.
Have you done color work before?
No, this is my first time.
Okay, how are you finding the color work? Because that's another thing that I'm a little bit anxious about starting this sweater, is that I've never done color work and it seems like a lot of color work.
I'm slow.
Okay.
But I don't let that bother me. I feel like I want to get one of those fancy little colorwork needles. I think I've seen them on Wool and Pine's Instagram, where you can kind of have them, because I'm a continental knitter, you can have them on your finger that's holding the yarn and slide one strand through one and one strand through the other.
Oh, like the metal thing.
Yeah.
The metal one.
But I don't have one of those. So I just pick up the next color and go on. And it's not a fast process. But I love a color change in yarn. I am an absolute sucker for any sort of variegated yarn where the color change happens automatically, or where I get to play with different colored yarns. Doing a single color project,
I think,
is not my vibe. So
I think it would also make it really interesting. Mm-hmm. So because it's a lot of stockinette, so you're just knitting.
Yep.
But then you've got to alternate the colors,
and you do expand as you go. As well.
Oh, the increases.
Yeah, so there are some increases. And hot tip, if you are starting it, you're going to have a lot, a heck of a lot. Can't see, it'll be in our Instagram, but you'll have a lot of
floats.
A lot of floats in the back. And so it's just about making sure that you give yourself enough stretch room for those floats. So I've been very careful to do that as I go. So, but delightful project, having a lot of fun with it.
So I've just noticed your project bag and my project bag. So I thought maybe we could just, I'm just going to show it because we have the same one. Twinning is winning. These are from Crystal Cat Stitchery, and we bought these bags last year at the Bendigo. I think it's the Australian Wool and Sheep Show is the formal name of it, but everybody around here knows it as Bendigo or Spendigo. And we bought these bags and they're fabulous. There's little pockets on the inside. The drawstring keeps everything tidy. There's no zips to catch your yarn in.
It's even got cute lining.
And that's
fabric,
which
is her logo.
Yeah. We love these bags. Probably we'll buy another one next year.
Yeah, almost.
Or this year. It's coming up.
One can never have too many project bags.
Definitely not. All right. So what's new to us?
Quite a lot, because we've just had Christmas.
All right. So these were things. I've got a couple of things that I bought before Christmas.
Gifts to self.
Gifts to self.
Gift to self.
I just had to get a copy of 52 Weeks of Easy Knits by, I think it's Lina. Is it Lina? Lane? Anyway, you've seen it, I'm sure. It's been all over Instagram. And I've really loved looking through it and planning some projects. I particularly love this sweater by Meju KP. Not sure if you can see it, but it's a looks like a top down raglan with a bit of a stripe, but the stripe is the same color as the other. The other one is a Paula Pereira design called Comfy. Let me see if I can get a bit closer. That's better. Love that shaping of the yoke in that sweater. And this one by Elena Solier Jansa is called, it's a bit long, Brisna. And I have some red yarn at home that
it's
might
need a
that.
Pattern.
It does need a pattern. I love that. It's chock full of fabulous projects that are mostly in worsted weight or Aran weight, so it will take
quick
no time at all.
Knits.
Quick knits.
Love quick knits.
I know. So gratifying. On the same day, I went to Maker Maker, and that's where I got this book. And then on the last episode, So I think it was episode one, I talked about how I got some yarn to substitute for my MCAL. Well, then Natasha Hornby came out with the Yvonne MT shawl, and I thought, oh my goodness, that yarn will be perfect for an Yvonne MT. So now I've bookmarked that yarn for that project, and then I needed more replacement MCAL yarn.
What a pity.
What a shame.
What a shame.
So I bought more Darnie, which is another new favorite of mine. So they actually don't have color names, they have color numbers. So the light pink is shade 8815, and the dark pink is 8807, and they are exquisite.
They are really beautiful.
And not in focus, but that's okay.
And then this will be your ColourPop.
The ColourPop, right, a neutral, how good.
Which is shade 8812.
It's 100% lamb's wool. It's fingering weight. It, I think, will, once washed, become quite soft. It's softer than Holst, super soft. And
it is the yarn that still has the spinning wools.
It is
spinning oils.
It
there,
is in so, the oil. Yeah. So, again, I bought this and I had to resist the temptation to immediately cake it and cast it on, because I was trying to finish Mautinoa. But now that Mautinoa is done, I feel like it's a little bit game on.
Yeah, I know what you're doing this afternoon.
Possibly.
Well, I also got a book. My partner bought this one for me. You may have guessed, we've talked about Stephen West a little bit, particularly in our first episode. Big fan. So I got the Painting Shawls book. Lots of beautiful painting shawls patterns, so painting bricks and lots of different types of patterns in there. I think a lot of them are available to at least see pictures of on the on Instagram. But I just had to show
the photography.
I just love the wild choreography of everything Stephen does, and the incredible like makeup on the faces of the models. This person has some shiny silvery paint on his forehead. Yeah, gorgeous
oh,
book.
That's fabulous.
Yeah. Lots of fun colour, and it's a lovely thing just to look through while you're trying to plan your many shawl projects. So
I have yarn bookmarked, can I call it that, set aside to do painting waves. So that'll be another hopefully 2023 cast on for me.
Watch this space.
Another book that came into my life this year. I forgot to bookmark the sweater that I love out of this. My partner got me the Arnie and Carlos Knitting Scandinavian Style. It's fabulous. I love these types of patterns. It's something that I'm really interested in knitting, but I say I don't have the guts to do it. I just did Mautinoa, which was...
You've got the guts.
The most complicated knit I have ever done in my life. And this is the sweater that I think I will make out of this book. It just has this beautiful traditional pattern at the bottom. And I love a good turtleneck. You know I am totally game for a turtleneck. Not today, it's 35 degrees, but normally... I love a good turtleneck. So this book has a little bit of history on the patterns, and it's got some sweater patterns, some pillow patterns, a draft stopper pattern, which actually could be quite handy. So I'm looking forward to getting stuck into this. I've also found a source for the actual yarn that they use, so I don't necessarily have to substitute yarn. So I'm pretty excited about that.
My other big acquisition is this fabulous blocking kit.
It's so good.
From Coco Knits. So previously, my friends, I have blocked by spreading multiple layers of towels on a queen size bed and putting air conditioners and fans on there and really, 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 really hoping that it would be dry by the time I needed to go to bed at night.
And Melbourne's climate's fairly humid, so things don't, especially wool things, don't necessarily dry that quickly.
No, no, there's been all sorts of creative, fast drying scenarios occurring. Anyway, I think my partner decided that it was time to not have the bed taken over. So this was a Christmas gift. And I just want to go into this a little bit more because it's a particularly lovely blocking kit. It's got this, so it's got the normal sort of white foamy on the back. And then on the front, it's got this lovely, like kind of almost carpet-like fabric. So that when you're blocking, it your garment kind of sticks to it a little bit and it helps you really smooth it into mm-hmm. shape.
Mm-hmm.
It's also got these lovely big T-shaped pins that make blocking, little tin of T-shaped pins, which makes blocking really easy, particularly if you are really, you probably can't see that, but trying to hold something in shape.
Like if you've got a chevron edging or any kind of lace shaping edging, the pins are very helpful, especially if you don't have any blocking wire.
And this is cool too, if you're trying to get gauge. So this is, look, it looks like a tablecloth, but each of the little gingham squares are an inch by an inch. So if you're trying to get exact gauge because you're making a garment, then you can lie it out. They suggest you put this over the top of your blocking mat and you can stretch it to exactly the right size so that you know it's going to fit when you try it on at the end. And gosh, you want that, don't you? After spending months on a project.
It's fabulous. It's not inexpensive, the kit. Like I know a lot of people just get the little kind of foamy blocks from like your local Kmart, but I think I have this kit at home as well and I think it's spectacular.
It is a joy.
Worth the price.
I actually asked when I got the kit, did you get advice from Gay? Lucy's like, no, I did my research. So well done, honey.
I'll just mention a couple of other things. If you follow us on Instagram, you'll have seen I had a little trip to the Yarra Valley and went to Crumb's craft shop. They do not only yarn, but fabrics and other crafts. So it's worth popping in if you're in the Yarra Valley area. And while I was there, I picked up... so I've been having quite a bit of anxiety this summer about... my stash and keeping it moth free. So while I was at Crumbs, I picked up this really cute, it's a bug buster and it just smells beautifully. It doesn't smell like, you have a sniff. It doesn't smell like your traditional mothballs or camphor. So I picked that up and as
very
well.
Very citrusy.
Yes. Yes, I just like it.
It's lovely.
And then a few miles down the road, kilometers down the road, sorry, that was very American, is the Waratina Lavender Farm. And while I was there, I got some room spray as well in lavender. And I thought I could just occasionally spritz that around.
Very calming.
It will be calming. Very calming. I probably should have sprayed it while I was... working on that I cord last night. Never mind that. And my last acquisition is a Knitpro. Okay, so confession, I really wanted the Mindful interchangeable needle set, right? You know me, I love
tools. Well, anything.
Really. I just want the whole set. Yeah. Like, I don't want to have to fuff around with, like, where's this needle? Where's that needle? Anyway. But they were sold out at Crumbs, which was okay, right? It saved me, what, $150? Anyway, I had to buy a cable, and I haven't opened it yet. I think I'll use it for my next cast on. But their new Mindful collection has swivel cables. So the normal Knit Pro, the normal Knit Pro cables are not swivel, which is fine. You just have to, I guess, be more mindful with them, but I don't know.
This one does the mindfulness for you.
It does the mindfulness for you. But they're also compatible with our other set. Yes. So Nicole and I both have I think it's Leike, what is it, Cypra? They're copper. Mm. They're copper needles. And those come with swivel cables. So I don't know about you, but I've been putting those on my Knit Pro tips. And now I can have a Knit Pro cable that does the same thing. Thank you, Knit Pro, for making a swivel cable. So those are our acquisitions.
Quite a lot. I don't think we'll have that same level of acquisition next month. We probably will.
Yeah,
we'll see.
Yeah, let's be honest.
You might.
Anyway, acquisitions done, dusted. Well, that just about does it for us for today. Since this is our first episode for 2023, hopefully the first of many, like Nicole said at the beginning, we really want to be able to highlight the Australian wool industry from basically paddock to project. Let's call it that.
Paddock to project.
Love that.
Ah, ta-da.
So for 2023, I guess beginning of the year, kind of set some knitting goals on how we, well, if you're like me, you may have set some knitting goals. So when I was working on the Mautinoa, I just kept thinking about how much knitting was going into it. And I thought, I think this year I will have like two main projects on the go. Perhaps one shawl project. There's a lot of shawls that I have already purchased yarn to make, and I really want to actually get stuck into them, but that equally there's a bunch of sweaters that I want to make. So I thought if I have a shawl project on the go and a sweater project on the go and I just kind of alternate days, I'm gonna make some pretty good progress with that. I spend probably about an hour a day minimum knitting. It's kind of how I de-stress at the end of the day. So I think that will serve me well. And then if I can keep that going, I'll have enough, like it will prevent me from just starting all these projects, which clearly I have done.
How many projects do you have on the go at the moment?
Probably five.
Oh, that's slow for you.
Well, I finished Mautinoa and that was epic. That was epic. So, Nicole, do you have any knitting goals or plans for your knitting for 2023?
No. Don't think I do. I am not a big planner when it comes to knitting. I, for a little while, did start a Ravelry queue, and now I find it intimidating, so I don't look at it. I tend to like to follow whatever is grabbing my heart at the time, so whatever is inspiring me at the time. So I'm really excited about working on the Paul Klee sweater, which we should have said earlier, is by Midori Hirose.
Yes.
And other than that, I think I've got a few working projects, a few whips to get through. I've got a baby, well, it's a toddler blanket. The child is now almost three. So I've got a toddler blanket that I have a little bit of a time pressure to finish, which I might showcase in our next episode or the one after that, depending on the time pressure. But other than that, I rather expect that there'll be all kinds of things popping up here from me.
Mm-hmm. I think it is something to be said for balancing the planning versus leaving room for the new and unexpected, because our favorite designers just come up with something and then
constantly.
You just want to drop everything. You're like, I want to knit that. And that's probably happened to me about five times during the month of December.
Yeah. And we're a little way off retiring, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So we just don't get enough knitting hours in the day.
No.
Anyway, let's make some knitting hours in the day. I think maybe we should wrap it up there.
Okay. Let's go knit.
Thank you very much for joining us. Please, as we said at the beginning, we would love you to comment on our episodes. Let us know what you like, what you don't like, any ideas or anything that you would like to know more about, any questions you have about us or about the Australian fibre industry or projects that we're working on, and we will do our very best to answer them or address them in future episodes. If you do like our vlog or our podcast, then please do subscribe. That helps it get in front of more eyes and ears. And all of the notes, everything we've talked about today, are below, so please let us know if you're working on the same things as us. You can also find us, we post really regularly on Instagram, which is @PurlfectPairings. Have a lovely day, everyone.
Happy knitting.